Francis and the Paulist Fathers of Cathedral, who support the concert series and, of course, run the parish and the diocese. We welcome you to this beautiful, beautiful place. Cathedral loves music, and so as a music director, I am in awe of the work that I get to do here and of the beautiful music such as you hear tonight that I get to enjoy and sometimes take part in. I'd ask if you would please, at this point, turn your cell phones off. That would be terrific. And any other contract devices, if those would be silenced. Thank you. The Paulist Fathers, who run a cathedral, publish, they're a national society, and they publish a calendar of the year. And wouldn't you know, in December of this year, is featured the Men and Boys Choir. It says, the Choir of St. Andrews. Well, I wish. So, welcome to the concert tonight. I'm so glad that the Men and Boys are part of the Cathedral Concert Series and part of our musical family here and, of course, in the city. Tonight, as you are probably well aware, Dr. Martin Neary will be leading the boys through this concert. He comes all the way from England about once a year normally, sometimes twice, and it's just amazing to watch him work with the boys. A little more spit and polish here and there, and it seems to bring such electrifying performances out of them. So, I'm looking forward to this, and I hope you do as well. Please welcome the Choir of Men and Boys.
Good evening. It's easy to think that music for royal occasions should automatically be full of majesty and pomp. And we're certainly going to hear some of that later. But at the coronation ceremony itself, there are some very special quiet and solemn moments. And so, in this year's royal occasions program, by way of a change, we start our series of musical pieces with the very atmospheric call to wisdom of Will Todd, set recently for the Diamond Jubilee service of Queen Elizabeth II. After a pianissimo organ chord, you will hear the pure voices of the white choristers as they sing, Lord of Wisdom, Lord of Truth, before they are joined in background harmonies by the choir men. Our second piece, which is just for treble voices and piano, doesn't have royal associations, but I feel sure you'll appreciate why we wanted to include it. The moving text celebrates God's gift of Christ through the innocent eyes of a child, for which the English composer John Ireland found some ravishing harmonies as he portrayed the love which the life of Jesus inspires. On the other hand, We Wait for Thy Loving Kindness also written for a specific royal occasion, the wedding of the Queen of Prince Philip in 1947. And this time it's the turn of one of our temples, Bill Reed, to have the circle, which leads into some radiant alleluias. First sung very quietly, and then ending with a glorious crescendo. Our final anthem in the first group, And I Saw a New Heaven, has been sung at several royal funerals. The famous text from the Book of Revelation is set so expressively by Edgar Ayrton, the English composer who emigrated to Australia, that it's really a surprise that we don't know anything else that she wrote. I confess that I've never performed or heard anything else by Edgar Ayrton. But what a treasure it is, with each section of the choir having their moments of glory, the sopranos, altos, tenors, and not least the basses, as they sing and heard a great voice out of heaven. Well, that's quite enough for me at the moment, so now let's get on with the music.
Thank you.
deceptively simple setting of a verse from Psalm 34. O taste and see, which Vaughan Williams chose to write for the 1953 coronation. As the greatest English composer of the time, he'd been invited to compose whatever he liked, but to everyone's surprise, he chose this short text. Treble solos are being sung by Marcus Heidegger. Then comes Andrew Britton's Gugud setting of Psalm 100, which was composed at the request of the Duke of Edinburgh. It's a very powerful setting, enhanced by the virtuoso organ accompaniment. William Morton's links with royal occasions go back to the 1937 coronation of George VI, for which his Crown Imperial March was commissioned. But as well as being able to compose for massive forces, he also produced one or two miniature duels for choir a cappella. One of these is sent to me as a scene to the text from the Song of Solomon. And this has been sung in several royal weddings. Our tenor solos for Zachary Blues. I always think there's a strong influence of William Morton to be found in the music of the Welsh composer William Mathias. He certainly could also write rousing ceremonial music. And as you'll hear in Let the People Praise Thee, O Lord, he tests not only the choirs and nuns, but also the organist's virtuosity. We return now to Go Taste and See.
Thank you.
outstanding composers, but also a remarkable man. Early on in his life, he was sufficiently successful to be able to set up the Raythorne Williams Trust to help promote new music, but with one condition, that none of his own music should benefit. Which leads me conveniently to the subject of the offertory, which is about to take place. I still find it remarkable that these concerts given by this excellent choir should be free, but of course they can only survive if the audiences dig deep into their pockets. Earlier this week, we had an encouraging fundraiser for the choir, and we're very grateful for the numerous people who have already contributed, but we must build on that. And I hope you'll feel that perhaps tonight's performance deserves just a little bit more than you thought you were going to give. I know you'll feel guilty by the time you reach Handel's Anthem Begins Your Rejoice if you've held back. So now, while you're getting out your checks and forgetting how many notes you're putting on the ticket, Nick Palmer is going to play an appropriate, joyous chorale prelude part in Dies Freude in D is Gladness.
Thank you.
what I think is a very feminine communication. Because I don't think anywhere else in North America tonight are three people present who sang at the Queen's coronation in 1953. And it's a great thrill and pleasure for me to have two former contemporaries of mine at the Chapel Royal sitting in the front row who've actually driven over from Rose Island to be with us this evening. So do stand. joining the altarists this evening in the hand. He also thought that you might have a few light-hearted encores, and chose the title After Hours. So, in a change of mood, we go from hand to Hope Dalibor. Then over the rainbow, and then actually a very moving piece by a former Westminster County chorister, Do Not Be Afraid, which is on the choir's latest CD. And I was going to strongly recommend you to buy it. But do you know, I was very impressed with one of the choristers in the front row who actually had the idea of buying a copy for each of his teachers. Well, I think that's a brilliant idea, because not only does it spread the word of the choir, it shows the teachers what this kind of education discipline means for these boys, what they can do under such pressure to perform these works tonight. Some of them, in really complex, shows tremendous control, discipline, and the educational value of it is more than too many politicians know.